Fortunato de la Peña. Thank you, sir, for attending. Maraming salamat. Good morning. We have Undersecretary Carol Yurobe. Good morning. Morning po. We have Undersecretary Rowena Guevara. Good morning po. We also have from government as well, Director Jerry Clavicillas from DTI, ang aking suking resource speaker, who's always with us. I think that's it for government. From the private sector, we have Dr. Edsel Salvania from UP Manila, my batchmate in many ways. Ms. Maui Arroyo, President and CEO of Hyperdime Consulting Incorporated. Mr. John Orlina, COO of the same organization. We have Ms. Bam Besa, co-founder of Road to Retail. Another Bam in the world. Konti lang tayo. We met already. I cracked the same joke the last time. Ms. Shumate Royo of Office Project. Magandang umaga. We have Mr. Leo Develos of Idea Space Foundation. Mr. Dan Siason of Kickstart Ventures. I see Joanne Yao there in the back, and other friends, magandang umaga. Good morning. Okay, before anything else, let me acknowledge for the record the members of the committee. So I'm chairing the committee, and our members from the majority are Senators Angara, Ejercito, Villar, Zubiri, and Legarda. From the minority is Senator Trillanes, and our ex-officio members, Senators Drelon, Soto, and Recto, who used to be the chairman of this organization. Okay. All right, and again for the record, we move to adopt the rules of the Senate in the conduct of hearings, meetings, and investigations of the committee. Nobody's going to object, obviously, because I'm the only one here. We'll strike that from the record. No objections, so we adopt the rules of the Senate and the rules of procedure governing inquiries in aid of legislation. All right, magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. So let me begin by the good secretary and I had a short meeting earlier, and we talked about some priority measures that we will be tackling. For those of you who've attended my hearings in the past, we try our best to really get a consensus from the private sector and from the government sector on the reforms that we want to push. We try to be very purposive with the reforms we're pushing. We try to prioritize also which reforms we'll be pushing first. So far, what we've talked about, I think, are quite doable for the 17th Congress. But I'd like to hear it from Secretary De La Peña himself. Sir, are there top three or four legislative measures that you would want to see passed in the 17th Congress?
Thank you, Your Honor. As we have earlier discussed, the priority bills that we would like to see passed has something to do with, number one, the nuclear applications regulation, because there is really some pressure from the international community that the regulation aspect should be separated from the research and development and operational aspect. At the moment, the work, one on R&D and operations, and the other one on regulation of nuclear applications, is under one agency. So the clamor or the pressure is for us to have them separate and to be independent. The other one that we discussed earlier had something to do with the Balik Scientist program, because this has been an ongoing program, but there is really no legislation, and we would like to strengthen it, because one of the priorities in this administration that I am involved with is to really tap the expertise of people from outside. And we know that there is already a big community of Filipino expatriates working outside who have interest in helping our country. And we have already had this in structure on how they can serve. But we would like it to be, shall we say, strengthened through a piece of legislation so that we can really plan over a longer term. Then we have something that I have not actually mentioned this morning is an act that will strengthen our national measurement infrastructure. This is the amendment to the National Metrology Act of 2003. It was passed in 2003. This is Republic Act 9236, which established the National Metrology Institute under the Department of Science and Technology. The bill that we want to be passed is the establishment of the National Metrology Institute after the passage of the National Metrology Act in 2003, because this is necessary to provide capability building programs through competency training to strengthen the metrology authorities at the local level. So again, this is one area that we sort of have lagged behind. Although we were able to pass the Metrology Act, the accompanying capability building has not been well. And while we have at DOST now provided for a substantial budget to acquire the needed equipment, still an institute, I think, is in order. So maybe the other bills that I mentioned to you are the possible passage of the Space Technology Agency, because there has been good morning, Senator Gatchalian. Because there has been activities already in the area of R&D that we have undertaken, where we have invested on, and we feel that there should be some direction to this. Yeah, so the others that I have mentioned had something to do with the amendment of the Magna Carta, and also there is a proposal for a comprehensive science and technology policy. We have not yet, there is no bill yet on this.
Sorry, could you repeat that, Secretary? Proposal for?
This is an act establishing a comprehensive science and technology policy. So, actually, this is the first time I've seen this.
Yusek Guevara.
As you may know, Senator, the EO-128 is the basis of DOST right now. And there are certain things due to advances in science and technology that are not included in that 1987 EO. And we believe that the country will be strengthened further if we put S&T in the front runner. So that is exactly what we would like to accomplish in this bill.
Well, maybe just for discussion, what would be the salient points of that bill? Yusek Guevara.
The salient point of the S&T bill would be to state the role of S&T in all aspects of our economy, our socio-cultural activities, and all of those things. But mostly to put the role of S&T in everything that we do. Because right now, parang we are a footnote. We are not even included in the Philippine Development Plan as a chapter. And so we need to strengthen the S&T policy of the country.
Thank you. Let me acknowledge Senator Gatchalian. Magandang umaga, Senator Win. So far, we're talking about the priority measures from the DOST side. So they've been talking about what are some of the reforms they would like to see in the 17th Congress. Anything else, Secretary De La Peña?
I did mention earlier to you, although I have not discussed this with my colleagues, the idea of maybe having a Philippine Science High School in ARM.
Thank you. So far, you know, from the DOST side, we have the clarifications on regulations on nuclear materials. We have the Balik Scientist Program to institutionalize the Balik Scientist Program. And maybe I can ask Dr. Salvanya, who is a Balik scientist, no? Is Ms. Maui also a Balik scientist?
No.
No? Okay. mukhang scientist. Well, just scientist. Ni Balik scientist, no? Okay. Dr. Salvanya, maybe you could, if you have any thoughts on this matter.
Yes, I think that I fully support that idea of the Ibalik Scientist Bill because I have benefited tremendously from it. I think that part of the reason why we have been proposing amendments to the Magna Carta for Scientists is to strengthen the retention of Balik scientists. I'm both a clinician and a researcher, and so from a clinician standpoint, I can generate enough income to keep my family happy. But for the vast majority of our scientists in the Philippines, it's actually almost, it's pitiful how much we value them. And that's, you wouldn't be surprised why they're leaving because the salaries that we offer our scientists are a pittance compared to their contributions to the country.
And the salaries are from the private sector or from the public sector?
Both, actually.
Both.
And because, as Yusek Guevara had mentioned, we are a footnote. It is we do not value our scientists, but there was a very comprehensive lecture of Yusek Stella Kimbo Alabastro in our last NIH anniversary where she actually charted the value of the Filipino scientist, and there's a lot of indirect benefit that is not necessarily quantifiable based on what you're putting in, but it is one of the best investments. I'll give you a good example. NASA in the United States, which is seen as a science, as a basic science area, has generated so much in terms of the downstream economic benefit, and it is one of the best investments that mankind has ever made.
Thank you, Dr. Salvagna.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, go ahead.
Mr. Chair, before we go deeper into the Balik scientists, I just want to make a manifestation. I filed the bill, actually I filed it last Congress, and then I refiled it this year to establish math and science schools all over the nation. I think particularly the highly urbanized cities and the cities in particular. Our experience in Valenzuela, in fact, when I assumed mayor in 2004, we had what we call Valenzuela Science School, but we added mathematics because our experience in Valenzuela, a lot of our students fear math. So we renamed the school into Valenzuela Math and Science School. It's one of the more modern math and science school in the nation. And our experience there has been really positive and tremendous. In fact, a lot of the students who graduated there end up being engineers, going to UP, or taking up really complex courses. And nakakawa po, no? Because when I was going around the country, ang dami nating magagaling na students. Unfortunately, they're not harnessed, no? They're not given the training that they need to really bring out the best in terms of math and science. And kasi hindi pa kalat, no, yung math and science school natin all over the nation. So one of the, it's a simple bill, no? I'm sure, I don't know if it's going to land with you or with education. Actually, coincidentally, the chair of the Committee on Education is Senator Bam also. But it's a good project to promote math and science all over the nation. Ngayon kasi concentrated siya in highly urbanized cities, but we cannot discount the fact that we have brilliant students all over the nation in far-flung areas that we need to rigorously train them.
Secretary, maybe you can, before we go to the Magna Carta for Science Workers on this point, maybe you can give us an overview of how many science high schools there are in the Philippines.
Before I do that, Your Honor, I just want to mention to Senator Gatchalian that they should not be surprised if there will be visitors to the Valenzuela Science High School because I have also been approached by a number of cities asking us to put up a science high school in their locations. But we are following the law that there should be one per region. So I was telling them, I think you should visit the Valenzuela Science High School because this is good for benchmarking. Because for me, I have witnessed how fast it has grown, and because of the students winning the competitions from Valenzuela, I gave them the idea of visiting. Okay. Anyway,
is the Valenzuela Science High School part of the? It's not. It's an LGU school, diba?
It's an LGU school. We complied with the requirements of DepEd, no. But it has nothing to do, I think, with the DOST, no. Which is actually maybe we can do something to put that together. But the bottom line here is the students undergo rigorous math and science training, and they are the test and the qualification is much higher compared to an ordinary school. So these students really, kumbaga sa Olympian, mas intense in training itong mga students na ito. No?
If I may proceed with the briefing on the Philippine Science High School, the Philippine Science High School is now a 52-year-old institution being set up in 1964. Initially, there was a single campus, the one in Quezon City, and some of our guests have graduated. Then later on, there were campuses that were set up in Davao and Iloilo, and later in Palo, Leyte. Now, after that, a law was passed that there will be a Philippine Science High School in each region of the country. And therefore, between the years from 2000 up to 2016, we had been busy setting up the campuses. And we are happy to report that as of August 8, 2016, the last two campuses opened their doors to their freshman students. I'm referring to the Zamboanga Peninsula campus located in Dipolog and the Mimaropa campus located in Romblon. Well, that completes the 16 that we are supposed to set up. There, of course, if the Negros Island region will really be put into place, then we will need to put up one there. So in terms of enrollment, Mr. Senator, Your Honor, the main campus has the biggest enrollment because we take in around 240 freshmen every year, while in the regional campuses we take on 90 per campus.
Mr. Secretary, if the goal was to put that in all the regions, kung all provinces or all highly urbanized cities, for example lang, could the OST still handle it?
Oo naman, Senator. I'm just afraid that when we go that far, baka DepEd might already question it.
Okay. Maybe we can... Buti nilang kaalala ko yung chairman ng education, di ba? Pwede tayo, we can have a separate discussion about that. One of the discussion points about the science high schools is that they have a much larger budget than the regular high schools. Is that totoo ba yun?
I don't have the figures, but I believe we have a higher budget than the typical high school.
But what Yusek Guevara said, na putting science and technology front and center, means it has to start from, I mean, it just can't come at the end. It has to start from the beginning, and probably supporting our science high schools means sa simula pa lang, habang kabataan pa lang, natitrain na kaagad sila. No?
A program at the Science Education Institute, this is one institute of DOST, one among 18 agencies of DOST that is devoted primarily to scholarships. They do not run the Philippine Science High School, but they are in charge of the scholarships from the baccalaureate up to the PhD level. But it is also an institute that is tasked to render training for science and math teachers with the cooperation of DepEd. We cannot just do it without DepEd's cooperation. So we have a program called STAR. This is the Science Technology Academy in the regions, and this is the venue by which we try to assist the science and math teachers in the regions, particularly in areas where we have collaborating agencies.
Secretary, just ano lang no, because the one based on our experience, no, the Valenzuela Math and Science School is under DepEd, no, the operation and maintenance is under the local government because it demands higher budget in terms of operating the school, but the teachers and the curriculum comes from the DepEd. Would you know whether there's a big difference between the DOST-run science school versus a DepEd science school? No? Because, sorry po, when we were formulating the school, our initial reaction was really to jump with DepEd. No? But apparently, there's DOST also runs its own schools. No?
Dr. Kabati is the executive director of the Philippine Science High School. Maybe he can enlighten us. But as far as I know, when we were about to implement K-12, there was really a lot of convergence that was done between DepEd and the Philippine Science High School. We were part of the training team for the preparations to K-12.
There a big difference between. Good morning, senators. It is indeed a fact that the Philippine Science High School System curriculum is significantly different from the DepEd curriculum, because ours is more in depth on science and mathematics, and rich in science and mathematics subjects.
Research also.
As well as research.
In terms po of itong 16 po is fully funded and operated by the DOST.
Yes.
But
through GAA.
So the main difference really is the research oriented curriculum, as well as intense focus on science, math and science, no?
Maybe as far as the City Science High School, because I have been witnessing their participation in many of our competitions, like Valenzuela, Pasay, Makati. I believe that they are following also a very science-oriented.
So far naman, our experience has been quite tremendous. But siguro in terms of streamlining, do you think there is a need to maybe, in terms of math and science schools in particular, should be supervised, no, by the DOST instead of DepEd, no, just to be streamlined, like kami po. Actually, my chain of thought goes to, I think you should also look at the local governments, no, because a lot of the local governments are really willing to put up their math and science school, and most of the highly urbanized cities have the cash and the budget to do it, no. And ang kulang lang nila talaga yung technical know-how, how to set it up, the curriculum. But ngayon po, I mean, I'm just thinking out loud na baka mas maganda to Valenzuela Math and Science School to partner with DOST, because you've been running these type of schools, no? Anyways, and this is, I would assume, part of your inherent mandate, no? As DOST.
Your Honor, we welcome partnering. Okay, we just want to clarify the administrative supervision side, because I think that is not basically our mandate.
Maybe, Senator Win, we can have a separate hearing. We can invite DepEd here, and we can discuss the Philippine Science High School system.
If I may, Your Honor, maybe it's not only the Valenzuela City Science High, there are other science high schools which can be invited to have the discussion.
Yeah, okay, sige. We'll move on now to other matters. There was also a intention to pass the Magna Carta for science workers, if I'm not mistaken, Secretary. Maybe you can also ask. Alam ko si Dr. Salvano was the one who texted me in the 16th Congress about this bill. Maybe you could quickly talk to us about it, Dr. Salvano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Magna Carta for Scientists that we had proposed, and this was with working with former Secretary Alabastro, as well as Secretary De La Peña, is really tackles expanding the benefits, which is initially under DOST and government, to all scientists in the Philippines. And the rationale for this is really that, as we had already mentioned, we're training so many science high school students, but we're basically training them for the rest of the world. Because when they graduate and they're looking for science careers, the salary that we can compensate them here is minuscule compared to the rest of the world. And so the amendments that we proposed include expanding this, also in terms of grants and aid for scientists, because right now, especially in government, we are constrained by salary scales and DBM circulars in terms of how much we can compensate our scientists.
Are we talking about scientists working in government or scientists in general?
Scientists in general, but for scientists in government in particular, there are agency rules that actually limit our compensation. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't matter if you get a United States NIH mm-hmm. grant, which will allow you to earn $200,000 a year, you are constrained by the rules of double compensation that you can only get whatever your salary scale is plus a certain amount of honoraria.
So what you're saying is, limited ba nga yung nabibigay ng gobyerno, nililimit pa yung pwedeng makuha outside?
Absolutely, even if it's on your own steam. And it's a third-party funder.
Right. Let me ask Ms. Arroyo of Hybridime. I think you also have a position paper on the Magna Carta for Scientists. Ms. Arroyo.
Thank you, Mr. Senator. We've been working at the firm with scientists for the last 12 years, both in those working in state universities and colleges and in private sector universities such as the University of San Carlos, Ateneo, and La Salle. That's one of the reasons the position paper we submitted to your office to the committee is that we would like to extend the benefits for all academic scientists. I think the plight of the Filipino scientists is that we ask them to do 300,000 things at the same time. We ask them to do research, apply for research grants, publish their research, mentor their research assistants, do admin work, commercialize their research, and be on call for radio stations to ask any science communication questions. And we pay them a pittance. I don't think that we're asking for something that is too cushy, and we will not benefit from this, but the country will. But certainly, if the government cannot at least forego revenue in the sense of tax holidays for our scientists, I really think it will not move the needle too much on the BIR's taxation. I think that what is key is that we change the salary grade scale. And if we could have maybe different tracks for teaching, because some people have sublime research papers but should never be put in a classroom. Some people in a classroom should not be put in a lab. Maybe it would be good for the country if we differentiated between teaching, basic research, which is the quest for knowledge, and applied research, which is the quest to make a social impact. And that would help. And if we can make suggested metrics for promotion there. But I don't think we can treat them the same way that we treat LTO clerks, with no disrespect to the LTO. Thank you.
Maui, yes. you talked about research a lot, no?
Yes.
And it seems that research as a field doesn't seem to be highly valued in the Philippines. What happens when research is left behind? I know you've worked in other countries as well, and you've seen how the rest of the world is treating its science sector. Firstly, is it true that we're not really focusing on research enough? Secondly, is what happens if we don't focus on research enough?
Those are two very important questions, Mr. Senator. The first question being, is it true that we don't focus on research enough? I would disagree, because the entire Department of Science and Technology focuses on research. But it depends on who is appointed to the department, whether the focus is basic research or applied research. No? Basic research, focusing only, for example, on applied research or things that would make a social impact, is sort of like as a school focusing on graduation instead of enrollment. Eventually, you're going to run out of things to commercialize, no? But to focus only on basic research is a luxury that our country cannot afford with our limited resources. However, if you are going to international standards, it is wrong not to do any research, because they tend to be left with their thesis advisors. Most science students, after they graduate, never want to see their thesis again, which is understandable. But what happens is that you have a huge untapped spring of knowledge in our universities. And while certain legislative measures, such as the Technology Transfer Act of 2009, and certainly the Magna Carta, have tried to ease that into the private sector, the field is still in its infancy. And I think the OST and the universities, especially the SUCs, are doing the best that they can. IP Philippines under DTI has also helped in this regard. But I think the important thing for research, kasi, is that if we don't have enough critical mass, there are probably like 120 scientists who are running multiple research projects, because we don't have enough scientists here. And not all of them have the skill set to commercialize. No? That's difficult.
Will the Magna Carta, or the reforms of the Magna Carta, produce more scientists? Is that one of the output that we hope to see from the from the reform?
I think the expected outcome we would hope from, at least from our position paper, is that we keep more scientists in the country, and those who benefit from the Balik Scientist Program, like my colleague from UP Manila, will certainly stay longer. Thank you.
Yeah, Secretary, is that one of the goals, to keep scientists in the Philippines?
Yes, Your Honor, because there are actually two competitors here. Those who are doing research with in government, for example, or in the universities, they can really jump to industry, okay, but most likely not in a research type of work anymore. So, for example, our graduated, I come from the UP College of Engineering, graduated engineers with advanced degrees can do research in the government, or maybe some companies, but there are not too many who have their own R&D programs. But when they jump to the industry sector, most likely they will be into operations or in management, and so the R&D part disappears. The other temptation, of course, is the increasing mobility of scientists, not only region-wide, but globally. And you cannot really prevent them from leaving, considering the opportunities and considering their own needs. What has been brought up, I think I have also been a victim of this. You see the cap in terms of the honorarium that was supposed to be earned. Maybe this is off the record. Maybe it's, I retired from DRC with all the benefits, but somebody reminded me that at UP, I can still claim my Provident Fund contributions. So I started applying for my Provident Fund contributions. I think it was around 40,000 pesos. But then I had to clear again with the UP system after all the clearances, and I found out that I had a disallowance of 65,000 for honorary.
We need the scientist to fix his mic, no? Baka we can change his mic. I think it's better than technology workers that we limit the... So they have not... We are not being provided with the adequate compensation and incentive, and yet all of these are limited, the possible honoraria.
Okay, so I think this is something I don't expect we will receive a lot of opposition on this. We'll try to pass this as well as soon as we can. Hopefully that can keep our scientists here, alleviate some of the burdens that they have. Okay.
Able to launch the WATA, okay? Of course, the feeling is that it should not stop there, and there are so many shall we say, advances that we have to cope up with. There are still things that we have to do research-wise, and therefore we have allocated certain amounts for the next 2 years to continue the program. But my feeling is that there should be a goal that we should set. There should be something where it will lead to, and certainly considering our structure, it is implementing research implemented by UP people, but where does it lead to? So our idea is that it should lead to some regular operations of a space agency, because there are many applications that it can serve. And if I may mention also, we would not like to be left behind.
So in short, this institutionalization of a space agency primarily is really for micro, is really for satellite, no? Wala naman sa roadmap yung Philippine astronaut, no, Secretary? Is that, I'm not sure if that's in the roadmap, no? It's really more the satellites, no?
More of the satellites and the satellite technology applications.
Applications, no? And we're looking at usage in disasters, in agriculture, how do you call this, security. Maraming applications po yan. Right now, nakikisatellite tayo. Is that right, Yusek?
Right now, we are buying satellite tower.
So nakikisatellite tayo and may cost pa yon. If we have our own, then hopefully we don't need to buy from others.
Yes, Senator.
All right. So we will tackle that also in a separate hearing. I'm sure that will pique the interest of a lot of our countrymen. So although the group that did present to me said that we'll start with microsatellites, but who knows, maybe years down the line, we might even see a Filipino in space. Has a Filipino ever been in space? Never, no? Because if I'm not mistaken, one of the countries that they mentioned, it was another country's rocket, no? Or another country's ship, but they did have a... I think it was another ASEAN country that requested to have a Malaysia, ba? I think it was Malaysia. Who knows? Maybe we'll have a Filipino astronaut in our lifetime. No? Who knows? All right.
Point ko lang, Your Honor, is that I'll be more comfortable investing in research in this area if there is something it will lead up to.
Kung may bahay po siya in the end, no? Which is a National Space Development Agency, NSDA. I don't know kung anong acronym ba gawin natin, no? Okay, one of the bills that we want to push is the startup bill, no? And we've been talking about this bill since the 16th Congress, and we're quite happy that it fell into our committee. So we also invited a few people to give their comments on the bill. We're going to ask one of my staff, si Jose, to present the salient points of the startup bill. It will be brief, and this is just an overview. But what we wish to do, as well with the other bills mentioned, is that after this hearing, we'll call for separate technical working groups to flesh out the bills further, get comments from the different sectors, both from the agencies and from the private sector, as well as from our office. And hopefully, in the next succeeding hearings, we'll be coming to a consensus on most of these bills already. The startup bill, when we first filed it in the 16th Congress, for those of you who've been keeping tabs on this bill, has changed a lot, no? Because the first time that we filed this bill, it was really only focused on tax incentives for startups. Now, with a lot of consultation with different groups, it's evolved into a true startup bill. The coverage, of course, are innovative startups, which means it's not limited to just digital startups. But there is space for other innovative companies to receive the benefits of this bill. There are provisions regarding bringing in people from abroad, similar to the Balik Scientist program. There are some provisions on incentives, which we asked our friends from DTI to also give their comments on. And in any case, we really want this bill to be a bill that came from the sector itself. So that's why we've invited Idea Space and Kickstart and our friends from Office Project and other startups as well, because we really want to spur the development of this industry in the Philippines. A lot of private sector groups have said that we have really good ingredients of a startup community here, but there are still a lot of obstacles that they face. And we're hoping that this startup bill can unlock these obstacles and take away these obstacles to make the development of this ecosystem much faster and much easier for our digital and innovative startups. So let me ask Jose to take us through the salient points. Later, we'll ask for comments from the startups themselves, and then we'll call for a technical working group to flesh out the different points. No? Jose.
Oh, okay. This is going to be a very quick presentation of the startup bill. Okay, so we lift this from the Philippine Roadmap for Digital Startups, created by DOST ICTO, which is now the DICT. Well, the goal of the startup bill is to generate innovative startups. So we're not just focusing on new businesses, but we also want to attend to startups that really do anchor on technology to provide certain goods and services to people. Next. Okay, so the innovative startup that we use is one, is operating for no longer 60 months, whose core business functions involves product or process business model innovation. So we need some work on the definition for an innovative startup, but basically we want to focus on those types of businesses. And of course there will be some gross revenue and R&D expenditure and some standards anchored onto which type of businesses do we want to support as a government and which types of businesses do we allow the private sector to fund instead. Okay, and aside from startups, there are support service providers that also do complement the establishment of startups in the Philippines, such as providers of co-working space, incubators, accelerators, fabrication and design centers. And we also want to foster that side of the industry, because they are the ones who gather startups and allow them to interact more with each other. So we also want to prepare a set of benefits for them. First, a lot of the major pain point discussed by a lot of startups is the mainly problems in registrations and benefits. Although we recognize that DTI and other government agencies are already trying to ease in the requirements, while that's happening, we want to create a series of registration benefits that, one, would reduce the initial cost for businesses to set up, aside from expediting the process by which they can get their permits. Because normally we don't want these startups ideas, business ideas, to die in the registration line or because they don't have enough funds or knowledge to be able to register their business. So included there are waived fees and permits and certificates, refund and LGUs, fees and taxes for registration, and preference or expedited processing for their permits and certificates as well. For the tax benefits for startups, we're looking at targeting exemption for at most 5 years for innovative startups. We can discuss how do we scale down or graduate the rates for startups within that 5 years. And for support service providers, we want to offer them deductions relative to foregone income that they use to benefit more startups, such as through discounts that they may give or preferential rates for startups. Next. We also want to provide subsidies and grants, mainly for startups to establish by hiring competent employee or consultants for their innovative startups, mainly to scale or be part of their team, and subsidies to access support services, such as in co-working spaces, and subsidy to undertake or commission market validation study, because sometimes we need to orient them as well to not just learn more about their technology, but also for them to study the market eventually, so that they can transition from the laboratory to the market. We're also planning to create a fund that will be used to support initial or supplemental investment requirements for startups. There are a lot of discussions here on to what extent government must be involved when it comes to investing in startups. So this is still an open discussion, but we really want to be able to put funds into investing into technology-based new businesses. And mainly, we also want to be able to open our doors to a lot of players, not just in the region, but also for people around the world, we're taking often a page from innovation development plans, such as in countries like Chile, for example, who really opened their doors to a lot of startups to enter and set up shop in their country. So we don't see this as a competition, but we see this as a tool to expose us to the trends and practices of different startup communities abroad, and for them to be attracted into our country and to share that experience within the local startup community. So what we want to do is, normally the pain point discussed with us are mainly with visas. Normally it's easier for them to travel out of Hong Kong to extend their visa for another 2 months rather than for them to go through the renewal of their visa in the Philippines. So we want to rationalize that a bit and extend that to some extent so that they can be able to go around more in the Philippines without the hassle of going through a bureaucratic process that might be prone to some degree of corruption. So we want to extend their stay and simplify it through endorsement by a certified innovative startup or support service provider, or endorsement from the Innovation Council, which will be an inter-agency government body that we will discuss later. And as long as they provide existing and prospective business plan for innovative startup. It's a very basic requirement that countries such as Chile accept. You have a business plan, you're endorsed by a local startup, they allow you to enter into their country for a longer period of time. Next. So that was the general startup visa. Now this is a startup founder visa, mainly what we want to do to attract foreign players, foreign startups, to be able to set up shop in the Philippines. We've talked to a lot of foreigners who are establishing their startups in the country primarily because they want to leverage on our English proficiency, and at the same time with the skill set available in even in provincial universities. So basically, they enjoy from lower overhead cost when they set up shop here while they're developing their technology and trying to scale the market and their technology as well. So yes, basically it will accord them stay up to 3 months from the non-renewal or revocation of their innovative startup or support service provider, which means for as long as their business exists here, they will be able to stay with their business in the Philippines. And again, they just need a certificate for an innovative startup and their business permit, and they should be able to stay with their business here. And next is the startup employment visa. Normally, if you're a foreigner, you want to enter into a country to be employed, you will have to subscribe to an alien employment permit, which is what maybe banks or multinational companies would have to comply with. But if you're trying to look at a team of startup innovators, a team of three or four trying to invite a friend from maybe Singapore or Malaysia to enter into the Philippines, that type of process might be too rigorous for them or might be costly for them. So to some extent, we want to lower that burden for them. And essentially, this grants up to 3 months from the expiration of the contract of an individual employed in a startup. And basically, you just need, again, the endorsement from the startup and the certificate of the startup and the contract between the employer, Filipino employer of the startup. And next is the investor visa, which will allow the multiple entry with minimum capitalization requirement. This can be adjusted, of course, and this can be studied further. But basically, we want to attract investors to invest specifically in certified startups that we are going to recognize or establish in the country. Next, we want to create an innovation council, which is an interagency body with private sector representation. So we need to calibrate which agencies should be able to be part of the group, and what degree of private sector representation should be allowed in the agency. But mainly what it aims to do is to be able to monitor the implementation of this app, but secondly, to be able to spearhead and create, to drive the promotion and the development of the local startup ecosystem. And we want to be able to create our own startup website as well, because a lot of countries who really focus on promoting their startups have has a devoted startup website where applications can be made, where promotions can be made, and which promotes their startups as well. If you try to look at the startup website of Italy, for example, all of their businesses are cataloged in their website. So it's easy for someone searching through the web to look at, to understand the lay of the ground in Italy and what startups are there and know where they should go, how to contact a business in a very simple website. So we want to be able to create something like that to streamline our efforts to promote the local startup ecosystem. And just like what was discussed earlier, we want to be able to learn how to better assess the technology in terms of technology readiness and market validation, because we've had a lot of experience presenting technology to different to government agencies, to private sector, and we want to be able to assess the technology readiness of these of the innovations presented, so that we can easily tell them, so we can assess the technology readiness of the innovation that is regularly presented, and so we can better understand how we can improve the technology readiness and how we what are the proper intervention, so that they won't stagnate at a lower level, and so they can better improve forward. The same is true for market validation. At what stage are we able to validate the technology in terms of market application and eventual introduction into the market? So we must be able to really assess that, so that we can craft better intervention eventually. And then, of course, we want to embed it in educational programs. It's not just about supporting the current scientists, but also developing a next batch of scientists that will be able to benefit from these programs. So we want the DepEd, CHED, and TESA to pursue the creation and updating of programs to foster environment for innovation. And this can be done with parallel and complementary efforts that already exists. And the Innovation Council must endeavor the creation of programs, facilities, and learning institutions such as the technology technology business incubation facilities that is created by DOST, and similar efforts such as the design centers and fabrication labs. And of course, we want to be able to use current infrastructure and system to download all of this information and make use of the negotiation centers by training the business counselors of all of these programs and all of the easier processes that can be accessed by innovative new businesses in the country, such as maybe eventually when you're already more oriented into technology, you might need services from the IPO. You must be able to download those information and make sure that your go-to negotiation center in your nearest your city will be able to point you the right direction the moment you have a brilliant idea that you want to pursue. Okay, so that ends the presentation. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to acknowledge Senator Hirsito. Magandang umaga. Good morning. Welcome.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Morning, everybody, the resource persons. Making the most out of my day today.
All right, you're very welcome here, Senator Hirsito. All right, so these are the salient points of the startup bill, maybe from the startups or even the OST. If there are things that by no means are we finalizing this today, we will go into TWGs. But if you do want to see other things, or there are some things that you want to, that you're worried about from the initial salient points, we'll have an open discussion right now. Secretary.
Thank you. Good morning, Senator Hirsito. First of all, the bill is in complete congruence with our own plans. And maybe I should mention that at the Department of Science and Technology, one long-running program of ours that has been really appreciated is the so-called Small Enterprise Technology Upgrading Program. We call it SETUP. It has been running since the time of Senate Secretary Alabastro in 2003. And this time, I want to add two more layers, and it's exactly, if this is the setup, because we only entertain companies which are already 3 years in operation, then we will have a one layer below, which is the startup program, and then one layer higher, which will be intending to assist those that have graduated from the setup program. Now, I have only a few suggestions. First, the mention of grant subsidies and venture fund for startup is a very important component of the bill. And for us in government that are involved in implementation, it would do very well it will be very explicit that we can indeed give grants, subsidies, and venture capitalization for these startups so that we will not be worried about COA, okay? The second one is what will be the criteria for certifying that they are innovative startups. Maybe we can take a look at the guidelines being followed by the different technology business incubators because they have also a strict screening procedure. We can provide information on this. And lastly, I think it is a very good idea that you have shifted or shall we say renamed the bill into an innovation startup bill rather than limiting it to ICT, because I think initially I was about to suggest technology based startups, but then we also have the sector from the creative industries may not be exactly technology based, but I think they should be included in this particular bill. Thank you, Mr. Senator.
Thank you, Secretary. In fact, we had also struggled with a definition, no? And I think it's something that we'll probably discuss more in detail. But the current agreement was to use the word innovation, because innovation definitely captures the digital startup side, but also captures innovations in processes or in business modeling, which may not necessarily be digital, no, per se. So we think that this is broad enough to include a larger group, but also specific enough that we know who we're talking about, no, which I think is key. So, but obviously we will welcome your insights. No, the head of the Innovation Council is DOST, right? No, or DTI? It's DTI. Okay, but we can talk about that with Secretary Lopez. Who, I mean, if these programs are already in DOST, we can talk about who heads the Innovation Council. No, I think it's less of an issue. No, but. Definitely, we don't also want to start from scratch. So if there are current programs that we can just enhance or maybe increase the budgetary requirements to, that should be included in the bill as well. No? All right, maybe we can ask some inputs from the private sector. Anybody want to give a comment? Yes, from Hybridime.
I guess I will break the seal. Taking from Secretary De La Peña's point, I'll highlight two things also that he mentioned. One of them is that, of course, innovation spans social startups as well as life science-based startups. No, I think to have truly inclusive innovations which will promote inclusive growth and create jobs, we also have to think about the Marikina Shoe Cluster weaving in Baguio. We don't only want technology business incubators po kasi. We want kitchen incubators with big ticket items like ovens, more modern baking methods, no, that you can incubate little bakeries and restaurants. We also want art incubators so we don't lose our culture when the master weavers or the master sculptors die, no? And I think I laud the part of the act that recognizes business models as defined. However, because of that, I noticed that in the type 2 startups, which I guess in the office we like to call scale-ups, no, they've finished starting, and I think these are what Secretary De La Peña calls graduated na from the setup program. Na setup na po sila. At this point, they actually need purchase orders or access to new clients. They might not even need a loan, which the negotiation centers could help with. I think what they might need at that point is maybe tax breaks for the purchasing of either more R&D equipment, more manufacturing equipment. Because for those of us who are scaling up businesses, when you reach that stage, when you buy equipment so that you can serve more people or export, that's when it's almost like paying for the machine twice when it comes into the country, you know. So tax breaks would really help, because I don't think at that stage the business needs subsidies anymore. Pero tax breaks would be very welcome. As the second point that I'll echo on and slightly push back on from Secretary De La Peña is the venture fund. While I'm very happy that the council is composed of 30% of the private, 30% of the council is the private sector, I'm a little leery of having the fund only run by the government. Because historically, in Latin America, in Southeast Asia, and many other countries, government's mandate is really not to invest. So I was hoping that maybe we suggested some matching fund so the government can invest with the private sector, because it's actually better if someone has the distribution, the sales, the manufacturing capabilities, no po. So obviously, if it's a small, like an ever-billionaire kind of thing, medium-sized industry, you can go 50-50. If it's a small investor in Kidapawan, the government can maybe sponsor 70%. Pwede naman pong sliding scale. But I think that if it's just the government po that decides, historically, it hasn't worked in any other countries, which is not to insult the capabilities of Secretary Lopez or Secretary De La Peña. Just data is data. So, yun lang po. Thank you.
It is what it is, diba? So, no, but we are cognizant of that, no? But to be frank, in general, government should not invest. But in places where there are gaps, government needs to step in. And I think there is a gap here. Now, clearly, I think the objective is for government to have more support for that financing gap for startups and small enterprises to be filled. How it will be done, I think, is also something we're discussing. No? Yesterday, the BSP was pushing for more of a guarantee fund, no? Rather than a loan or rather than an investment. They were pushing for more guarantees. And although, again, they said that there aren't very many guarantee programs that have worked so far, but that's what they're pushing for, more than loans. But in any case, this is exactly what we can flesh out during the TWG on ano yung, what vehicle or what form the support can come in. Now, the other thing that will probably be discussed and we'll need to get some guidance from DOF on this is the tax break versus subsidy debate, which is always a debate. No, for companies, it's easier. A tax break is easier because you don't have to go through the process of collecting. And collecting in government can be very difficult. No. However, government, on the other hand, wants to control the budgets, initial unrestricted budget. So there has to be probably a meeting in the middle, no? How to be able to provide the support, still satisfying the need of the businesses to have ease of doing business, but at the same time, on the regulatory aspect, hindi siya completely unregulated. No? Now, if I'm not mistaken, the Innovation Council does accredit startups. So there is that process of accreditation. So in effect, may control pa rin. It's not just an open... it's not an open benefit to everybody who decides that they're innovative. No, they have to go through a process pa rin of getting accredited, and the accreditation leads to the benefit. So I think in that sense, there are some controls already in the bill. But again, it's something we can talk about. No, maybe from Idea Space or Kickstart. Any Dan or Leo? Yes.
Hi. Good morning, Senators. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I am Dan Shazan from Kickstart, Secretary De La Peña. Just really briefly, and because, as you say, there will be further working groups, if you allow us to express our sentiments, we firstly commend and appreciate very much your efforts to kick off the startup bill, and we are excited to introduce changes for us to be more competitive. The general philosophy that Kickstart espouses is we think that, you know, most of the problem can be resolved by the elimination of structural impediments and not so much by subsidies or added funds from government necessarily. And I think once you eliminate or make more efficient these processes, we are more competitive, and thereby we will naturally attract funding from private sector from overseas. So, for example, today we can tell you from personal experience when we, in our activity, for example, we lose a lot to our neighbors like Singapore because investors are very much averse to regulation and over, you know, bureaucracy and certain inefficiencies, friction, if you will, in doing business. And so it is often seen as easier to set up a holding company in Singapore, which ultimately invests in the Philippines. So in a way, sayang. Because then we lose the direct benefit of participation. So that would be our general philosophy. And we look forward then to work with your working groups for more details.
Yes, and Dan, maybe you can also help us, since the startups with Kickstart are up and running now. So they're currently experiencing the issues that you talk about. Help us with that side as well. No? I know that the current administration is very adamant in terms of cutting down processing, cutting down red tape, so to speak. But we also want to put it in the bill. If there are structural impediments, let's address all of them as much as we can. No? So for example, we're trying to address the permits and ease of doing business by having that registration done through the council in the same way that maybe a PESA accredited organization does their accreditation and permits with PESA. No? Mm-hmm. So that's one way that we're trying to free that up. The other one is with regard to the foreigners, no, who are investing yes. here. And another structural impediment are the issues they face at the Bureau of Immigration. So yes. having classification, which will make it easier for them, and giving them longer time in the Philippines, for example, that's another structural impediment. Yeah. If there are others that we might have missed in the bill, help us by identifying this so we can really try to pinpoint reforms as DTI and DOST and the other agencies are working on their own reforms. No? So I think we can do it side by side.
We look forward to making inputs, and I believe we've submitted an initial yes. position, and we'd like to give you the specific pain points of startups.
Yes, thank you.
Share that with you.
Thank you, Dan. So Leo, Mr. Develes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First, we would like to express our support to the proposed bill, and we will continue to help in the fine-tuning of the bills. For me, as a startup founder, I have two things that I would like to share. One is the difficulties that I experience in complying with all the regulations, regulatory requirements. Our wish is to have it in one roof, so instead of you going to different places to go to Pag-ibig, SSS, BIR, etc., if it can be in one roof for startups. Because normally startup only have the founders doing everything, thousands of things, and the compliance with the regulatory requirements is also a pain. The second one is my observation on where startups die, because a lot of startups are actually idea driven or supply driven. We have a lot of ideas, we develop a lot of solutions, and then we start looking for the problem. So it's a bit different, and what we're thinking is if the government can change the dynamics, meaning instead of the startup ecosystem be supply driven, if the government can help on the demand side, meaning after we develop a product, when we go to our target customer, normally the customer would not really would like to buy the product, even though we thought they need it. But if the government can be helpful in the demand side, meaning part of the budget of the government can be used to purchase products of startup to solve government problems. Like, for example, if we want to solve traffic, if the government can purchase traffic solutions, even if you allocate maybe 0.1% of the budget for traffic, so instead of buying 1 million traffic lights from the normal supplier, you buy maybe 1,000 pieces from startups. So at least you'd create the demand, and you may not even need funding or subsidies or tax breaks, because there's a money there waiting to be used.
Yeah, thank you, Leo. Actually, on that point, in the 16th Congress, we also filed the Social Value Act, which basically tries to amend the Procurement Act to include other criteria aside from technical specifications and price. No? To be frank, at least three secretaries have talked to me about amending the Procurement Act, because it's getting very difficult already. Not only in terms of using government funds to support certain sectors, and even more than the startups, we want them to support community enterprises, local farmers. That's already one big budget item that can be used more intelligently or can be used more purposively. No? But their concern is really more the responsiveness of the agencies with regard to problems that they see. So there really are, there really will be moves to amend the Procurement Act. I guess, I mean, at the end of the day, DOTR, the emergency powers that they're asking for is largely with regard to the Procurement Act. DepEd has already said that their ability to be responsive to the needs of our children and our youth is hampered by the Procurement Act. R&D is hampered by the Procurement Act. DOH, in terms of the quality of our hospitals, is also hampered by the Procurement Act. It's the Procurement Act seems to be, it's ripe already for amendments, no? And the way that I see it is, and now that we're going into the budget season, ang laking porsyento ng budget natin goes into purchasing things, purchasing products. And if we can use that, my secondary goal then, which is developmental, which is we use it for our social enterprises, our community enterprises, our SMEs, our startups, for example, then you're saving money in the end because you might not need a venture fund anymore if government can actually provide that market already. Now, that won't be taken up in this bill. It will be taken up in the amendments to the Procurement Act, but we did commit to a number of these secretaries to help come up with a draft, no? Interestingly enough, it's such a complicated measure that we don't even have a draft right now for the amendments to the Procurement Act. So we've already asked a few think tanks, a few academic groups to come up with the amendments to the Procurement Act, and hopefully that can be addressed, and those issues can be addressed. Secretary.
There are three additional points, Your Honor. The first one is a suggestion to also study the possible role of local government units in the startup bill, because I think they can host startups. Some LGUs are very enterprising also. Secondly, see how the universities can support the startups from their R&D outcomes, because sometimes there are very restrictive rules within the universities that may prevent the researchers, although we have the Technology Transfer Act, but you see they also need some support, administrative, financial, or even just allowing them to do the startup without losing their tenure. Then the last one has something to do with the Innovation Council. I suggest that you take a look also at what the Intellectual Property Office had set up. They have created an Intellectual Property Advisory Council under IPO, which is essentially actually under DTI also. And, I was designated as chair. So maybe para lang magkaroon lang ng sa energy.
Right, thank you. Shumate or Bam, do you want to share anything about the startup bill? Yes, Bam.
Coming from the setting up a couple of startups myself, sir, the most of the concerns also shared by founders and people I've encountered in the tech space is that it's really the ease of doing business. The ideas are abundant, that is correct, as shared by Mr. Siazion. It's just that when it comes to regulating it, for instance, you have one founder, but you're required to incorporate, which requires five at a minimum. So not all can find four more into your corporation because you can easily outsource the other responsibilities. So that becomes a hindrance because you need to incorporate to be able to attract investors and to operate legally. So we're hoping that there are ways or means that we're in. There's another way to make it recognized as a legal entity so that we can do business legally, but not necessarily incorporating. Because sole proprietorship is not an option either because it's not different liability, yes, and the juridical entity recognized as a corporation is different as to a sole proprietorship. So we're hoping that it addresses avenues towards that, making and it's going to be easier for a lot more people to pursue entrepreneurship. So thank you, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Nahirap na ko to say Ms. Bam, di ba? Thank you, Bam. But we did file actually the amendments to the corporation code, which would put up a one-man corporation or one-person corporation. So that's in another bill. And that's something I think that the Committee on Trade right now is also looking at. SEC and DTI have been pushing for that for some time. So that will create a the provision for a one-person corporation where you have the benefits of being a corporation, but you only need one person to register. You don't need four other people to register. That's actually quite common in the rest of the world, except here. So we're hoping that can also pass in this Congress. No? Shumit?
I actually harp on the idea of Mr. Develas from Idea Space, which is to create a one-stop hub, like what we did recently with the OFWs, which is I find it really interesting and really would ease the transactions for the startup. As a co-working space owner, most of the problems that I've heard from the startup community that I am handling is the tendency of going to different agency just to process it. And when we're looking at the startup bill, the innovation startup bill, we see there are certificates somehow that they have to pass through. So one proposal that we would like is to at least cut down what are the requirements, because if we're gonna process or apply for another application form just to become part of that startup, it would be something, would be hard for the startup community as well. And then as much as, we know as well that it's not easy to start with your business, we would like also to propose the idea of, in terms of closing the business naman, it's not easy as well to close your business. Parang, I have a business before, and because of the many, I have to comply with all the requirements. I tend, sabi ko, wag na lang muna. I have to tend, tsaka na lang. But then there are repercussions for that. So hopefully, even the closing of businesses for those people na hindi talaga successful eh. Kahit anong gawin natin, 2 years na. Tapos na yung bill na pasok ako pero wala pa rin. So hopefully, even the closing of the businesses would cut down the process.
Thank you, Shumit. So, ano po, no? Let me just clarify that the startup bill is just one of a number of reforms that we need to do. As much as we can include these reforms in the startup bill, the things that we are mentioning, we also need other bills or other executive action, no? So, itong ease of doing business, this is already a goal of DTI, no? It's really part of the mandate naman to cut down processes, no? Tama na, Director Jerry, no? Cut down processes. And what you're talking about na simplifying steps and all of these things, this is not just for digital startups. It's for all businesses, no, in general. So I think there's a separate stream in terms of reforms for businesses in general. And then on top of that are benefits for our innovative startups, which is another layer altogether, which maybe not all businesses will be able to avail of, no? So let me ask Senator Hesito to share some of his thoughts also, especially with his experience in local government and with a lot of workings in government. Senator.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I concur with the Secretary De La Peña's suggestion that we involve the local governments with this startup bill, because most of the entrepreneurs, of course, they start small, and likewise, it's the local government unit that they will most likely deal with. No? So it will be very essential if we can really put in the bill that the LGUs be made active, no, or be an integral part of this startup bill. As also in our experience, Green Hills, San Juan is an entrepreneur's haven, no, and as such, we have a lot of big enterprises, Mr. Chair, started there, no. Nagsimula lang sila sa Changi, and then slowly developed their companies into big ones right now. So I will be very much willing to, of course, I'll be very supportive, especially with the innovative measures, no, that will be introduced, no. And likewise, I believe so much in the importance of automation and technology, because that's one of the very reasons why the local government unit, which I once headed, progress so much, no? So be rest assured, Mr. Chair, and I throw my support, no, to this startup bill, and I just like to probably hear a little some from the resource persons what provisions and things that they may want to suggest, no, that may we add, that we can add to this measure.
Action. I am very grateful for that expression of support of Senator Ejercito and his desire to have these LGUs involved. Maybe going further, I just would like to point out the situation in more developed countries wherein the LGUs are already doing their own work in the area of science and technology. So, for example, in other developed countries, the states themselves, they have their own science and technology offices and science and technology budgets. So, hopefully in the Philippines, some of the more progressive municipalities and cities can already think about science and technology in their own agenda. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary. Thank you, Senator Ejercito. So we'd like to open the maaga pa naman, no? We'd like to open the floor. Are there any other groups with suggestions on whether it's the startup bill or any of the measures mentioned by Secretary De La Peña? Meron po bang gusto mag-share? Yes, Dr. Edsel.
Yes, I think, thank you, Mr. Chair. And I think the biggest problem, and I'm really glad that the procurement bill was brought up, because this is really one of the things that's killing science in the Philippines, because especially if it's government funds, when government funds, say, for instance, say, go into UP Manila, we're subject to the same kind of regulations that the rest of the university is. You know? So our people get paid 3-4 months late. Our project should have started already. You know, it takes 6 months just to buy the equipment that we need to start up our project. And, you know, in my case, I'm a clinician as well, so it doesn't impact my own financials as much. But can you imagine our PhDs who have very limited salaries? They're taking money out of their own pocket to pay their research associates. And then between projects, the research associates don't get paid. So this is killing our scientists. And we are complicit, unwittingly, unfortunately, in destroying that kind of infrastructure because of the problems. In the United States, you know, they have those budgets, but you know, you have a scientist who is a PhD, who's studied for 12 years. Why do you have to hold them accountable for every single piece of paper? That just doesn't make any sense. It is what is, instead of having to think about the science and using all your energies for science, we're waging a battle on red tape, and we're trying to do our best under the circumstances, but it's just not really how to grow science in the Philippines. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I would like to speak not as an entrepreneur or a biologist, but I would like to speak as a graduate of Philippine Science High School and an employer of many Quezon City Science, Makati Science, Manila Science. I think that having more science high schools in local government units, as Senator Gatchalian said, is such a good idea. However, the investment you make in science high schools must be made in the teachers. We need a lot of good teachers. Three people at this table are graduates of Philippine Science High School, Yusek Gev, Dr. Salvania, and myself. Two out of three, quality isn't bad. I would be the not so good graduate. But there are many investors who are Philippine Science graduates who work at the World Bank as well. There are also many musicians and lawyers. And I think most of the people who are here are because we were also imbued with the love of country by our very good teachers. So no matter who has the mandate, if you want a science high school to work, you must give the dignity and good salary to our teachers who actually get paid less than call center workers, right? Which is why if we go back to the Magna Carta for science and technology personnel, that personnel also includes the teaching of our future scientists. Because if we cannot get enough people to do that, I feel for the researchers that Dr. Salvania has talked about. I actually know someone from MSU IIT who postponed her wedding because DBM had not
released the budget for, she had the grant from DOST, it's not DOST's fault, but DBM had not released the funds, so she postponed her wedding for a year. But I also feel bad for our teachers who grew old in the service of teaching hard-headed people like us. And if you want a science high school to work in your local government unit, you must get good science teachers. So I don't want it to be lutong makaw if Secretary De La Peña says it, but you should give DOST more budget in the General Appropriations Act if you want that to happen. And hopefully you should also give, and if it's under DepEd, then you should give DepEd more budget. That's my recommendation. Thank you.
Thank you, Maui. Anyone else? Yes, Mr. Leo.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I will reduce the statistics so in the fourth Philippine science, but I'm on the lower part. So 50-50 na. Now my comment will be more on the Balik Scientist program. I think we may need to strengthen the communication part because me, I'm not a scientist, the pure scientist. I'm an engineer, so I work in the private sector, but I came back to the Philippines to do startup on e-learning. But if I look at the guidelines of Balik Scientist, I may not qualify, but I'm into this Balik Scientist, a science scholar. But yeah, we need to maybe strengthen the communication and maybe encourage scientists in the private sector to also help. Maybe not in the research, but maybe in the management side or the risk, those kind of things. Thank you.
Thank you. Yusek, do you want to say anything?
I just wanted to say that we are already doing that now. Yes.
Okay. Secretary, maybe we can end with you, Secretary. So let's have Director Jerry, then for our last comments, we can have Secretary De La Peña.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor. The Department of Trade and Industry would just like to express its support to what has been presented by the Department of Science and Technology, particularly on their plans for the further research and development, Mr. Chair, because if there's any sector that benefits from the fruits of our science and technology undertaking, it is our MSMEs. Because based on records, most of the MSMEs neglect the research and development of their companies. So this is where the most of them are really looking up to the government to provide this intervention, and we are really supportive of that. In fact, one of our programs now, the shared service facilities, most of this equipment are generated now by the inventors that have been honed by the DOST. So we are now utilizing the fruits of the efforts of the department as far as promoting innovation in the small and medium enterprise sector, Mr. Chair.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Jerry. Before we ask Secretary De La Peña to give the final comments for this hearing, I'd like to acknowledge yung aking mga kasama, mga kaibigan at mga kapamilya mula po sa Tarlac City. I'd like to acknowledge Mayor Christy Angeles. Magandang umaga po, Mayor. Kasama po niya si Vice Mayor Aro Mendoza, Councilors Christopher De Los Reyes, Ana Aguas, Abel Basangan, Ricky Jolazo, Roel Quiros, and Vlad Rodriguez. Please stand up to be recognized. You're, of course, very, very welcome. Magandang umaga. Welcome to the Senate. And meron ba tayong Tarlac City Science High School? Parang wala, no? Ayun, sekretaryo, baka gusto nyo magtayo sa Tarlac City ng Science High School, no? Baka pwede. Alright, thank you for attending. Very welcome. Secretary, yes, you have the final word.
Teka, magpapatawa lang muna ako. Kasi sabi kang yun, ilan lang ang Philippine Science High School dito. So may excuse ako kasi nung panahon namin wala pong Philippine Science High School. Anyway, there is one thing about the point raised by Maui, which I think I would like to raise as a senior citizen. Because teachers who are very good, when they reach the age of 65, they are already prevented from joining government to teach. Maybe a newbie, you can be a professorial lecturer teaching one course each up to your 70. But I can see that there is a lot of wisdom and wealth of knowledge that these good teachers possess even beyond the age of 65. So I don't know whether something can be done about it, particularly in the government sector. The final word that I would like to say has something to do with the priorities also that we are setting in this administration. We really want to push faster development in the region, so we are paying more attention to region-based R&D, wherein the needs and the potentials of the region will be considered, and if possible, to involve the institutions in the region to do the R&D, if necessary, with the help of the bigger institutions. And lastly, we would like to seek the help of Senator Aquino and everybody who can help us so that the other line agencies can take a look at the outcomes of our research and development. Essentially, the three segments that we are targeting are, one, our other line agencies like agriculture, natural resources, energy, transportation, health, because we have done researches and product development thinking of their needs. It is not as if we did not consult them, because they are represented in our research and development councils. But you see, in the end, when the results are already here, it's very difficult to get them rolled out by the line agencies. So it ends up after the piloting. Now, there are other segments, of course, that we are targeting. And for example, when we held our technology transfer day, it showed such good results. This is really the business sector. When we show them the technologies that we have that they can possibly adapt for commercialization, and therefore we are cascading the technology transfer day to the regions. And of course, the last segment are the really needy fellow Filipinos, wherein the outcomes of R&D can really be deployed to help them, whether it is simply potable water or whether it is some basic things about sanitation or malnutrition intervention. We are doing that, but for that one we are not really shall we say expecting returns, but really just to help. So I would like to express our thanks to you, Senator Aquino. I think there is one thing very apparent: we think along the same lines in the area of technology-based entrepreneurship. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary. Let me just announce also that our next hearing on with science and technology will be tackling a number of the bills filed by my colleagues and myself on free Wi-Fi. But I think this will include the ICT. Of course, Secretary De La Peña is still very welcome, and DOST is still very welcome in those hearings. But we'll have that probably in a week or 2 weeks. This has been one of our advocacies for some time, and during that time, DOST ICTO was my main partner in pushing for faster internet in the Philippines. Now that they're in another department, we'll be tackling these hearings with the ICT, but I think the institutional memory of DOST would also be important in those hearings, so you're very welcome to join. We'll be now calling for TWGs on some of the measures mentioned by Secretary De La Peña. We've gone through a number of them today. We do hope that maybe within a month's time we can have all the comments in, so we can already have a consolidated draft on at least majority of the things that we had mentioned: the Magna Carta, the startup bill, the nuclear regulation amendments, and so on and so forth. And when we tackle this again in the hearing, I'm hoping that we can already have a consolidated bill that we all agree on and that we're all very happy with. So let me end there. I'm formally suspending this hearing, and let me end by thanking again all of our resource speakers, both from the government side and from the private sector side. Magandang hapon po sa ating lahat. Good afternoon. Magandang umaga.